More than likely, you have a vehicle that needs a new electronic speed controller to it. But when you get it, it might not have the right programming for it. So if that's the case, we are here to talk about programming your brushed ESC. I'm John Holmes, and stay tuned. Today's setup is going to be programming a BRXL ESC, or electronic speed controller. The process for programming most speed controllers through the computer is about the same, but this is what I have in hand and is also one that I'm very familiar with, and it uses Castlink. So we're going to show that to you. The items that you will need for it are the actual speed controller itself. Maybe this is already plugged into a rig. And if that's the case, you'll want to unplug it from the radio so that you can use the RX port for programming. You'll also need the programming adapter. In this case, it is the Castlink, or C-Link they call it. You can also use a field link from Castle in this case, and it works the same through the computer, or you can adjust some of the settings on the controller from the field link, but you don't get all of the settings, so I'm going to show you the complete programming today using the Castlink little chip here. And then we also need a USB cable that comes with the Castlink, I think, in most cases. And if not, it's the standard USB. Is that the micro? It's the old style. It's not as small as the new ones today. So whatever that is, the A, the B, y'all can figure it out, I'm sure. At any rate, it comes with a Castlink, so you don't have to worry too much about that. And of course, you also need a computer to program through a computer. Now, we will assume that you have already downloaded the program that you need for your ESC, whether it be Hobbywing or Tekken or Castle. So we're going to just start with the program actually pulled up on my computer. Now we're doing a screen cap of that, so you should be able to see everything that I see. The first step, after you open the program on your computer, so in this case, the Castlink 3.770, we're going to open that up. Now we're going to insert our USB plug into a USB port on the computer. The second step is to insert your Castlink programming chip onto the end of the USB cable itself. There we go. And when you do that, a little light will come on and the program will usually say, hey, I'm connected. And it gave me a little beep this time, but it didn't actually come up with this little down here. It says USB not connected on the software. A little red light is still on. So I'm going to unplug that from the computer and plug it back in one time and see if it recognizes it. Oh, the computer was installing the driver software, it says. There we go. So now the green light popped up. We're good to go. Next step, we plug the ESC into the programming chip itself. Now on a Hobbywing, there will be a separate port because of a patent that Castle has. So there we go, plug that in and bam, the software opens right up and shows what we're plugged into here. Now, as you can see, there's a few tabs on the top. We have our basic, our throttle curve profile, our brake curve profile, and the software. And let's see if the software is up to date. Here we go. Current firmware V109, and the current firmware on the ESC is V109, so we're good to go there. Now, throttle curve and brake curve is available on Tekken and Castle ESCs. Since Castle is the OEM for my BRXL, I have the same features on there. And we have just a straight linear throttle curve. You can change this and make it all funky, all that you want. Don't do what I'm doing here, that would be terrible. So what we're going to do is put it back to linear. Let's see, we can just, we can load a curve. There should be a default. Here we go. We should put it back to, there we go. Put it back to curve. And what we're gonna do is add the throttle curve that I like first. And that's usually somewhere around 30% throttle input, which is on this axis, and then 70% throttle input on the lower axis. As you can see, a nice gentle curve, gives you nice controlled startup down low, and then all the power that you need up high. Now we'll go to the basic tab. Since this is in a crawler, we want instant reverse, and we also want full reverse, so our reverse throttle needs to be at 100%. Since this is an ESC for a crawler, it's already selected there. Our brake mount, 100% is fine. Forward to brake to reverse is the instant reverse mode I was talking about. So we have proportional without reverse, which is essentially a lockout mode. This would be for racing, and we're not racing, so we don't need that. Forward to brake to reverse is when it waits for the motor to stop turning and then it starts going backwards. And then proportional with reverse lockout mode is when you would have a double tap reverse. And we don't want that on a crawler, so we're going to keep it on the stock setting here. And it may be called something else in another brand of software. The Tekin software may call this something a little bit different. The Hobbywing software may call this something a little bit different. But for the most part, they're pretty consistent in all of the terms that they use. On this one, we have a feature called quiet mode. And that essentially makes the ESC more quiet, or technically the motor acting as a speaker gets more quiet. More specifically, this particular feature would up our switching frequency from 13K up to 18K, if you're interested in what it actually does. But the ESC runs cooler at the lower switching frequency. Do you like the quiet mode? I do on some motors that are a little louder. So we're going to keep that disabled for now, because generally brush motors are not that loud. Let's see, what else do we have? Drag brake type on this particular ESC. What settings do you like for your drag brake? Passive drag brake is your normal drag brake, which we currently have set at 100% here. A Holmes hold is an active brake, which tries to push back. So if your motor spins, the ESC will actually push back and keep it from spinning. Do you like to use Holmes hold? If your rig is really heavy, sometimes the Holmes hold can be helpful for that. But it's really strong, and so if we're going to use Holmes hold, I'm going to dial the drag brake down, which also controls the hold, to about 30%. I typically never use that. I use normal drag brake at 100%, so we're going to set that back to the normal settings. What settings do you like for your drag brake? Currently, we have these two features as well called throttle up damping and throttle down damping. That's really just a kind of a muddiness to your throttle application. So it slows it down. If you grab the throttle, throttle up damping is going to slow that application and smooth it out. Throttle down damping would be when you let off, that it slows down the let off of the trigger. I never really used that. I originally had those put in for use with worm gears because they don't need drag brake, but if you just let off the throttle, the rig stops very suddenly and it's not very nice of driving. So that was more of a tuning for worm driven vehicles in particular, and I'd never drive worm rigs, so I don't actually use that. On our next firmware update, we may remove them because I don't think many people use that either. All right, we also have motor type, which brushed reversing is what we're gonna be using because we do want reverse. A brushed high power mode on this one is when both of the leads get put together as a positive output on the ESC, and then you strap into your negative wire for the negative lead on the motor. And this is very similar to the old racing ESCs back in the day. It's really not very useful for crawling. Of course, you probably want reverse, so we're not gonna even go there these days. There's not a lot of people who end up using that brushed high power mode anyway. We also have a feature called arming time on here, and this is essentially how long does the ESC wait for it to arm, and it wants to see a good signal from your radio, so a normal neutral signal from your radio. How long is it going to wait? In this case, the normal time, 1.5 seconds. It's going to give us a couple of chimes when it boots up and says, hey, I'm waiting, and then after 1.5 seconds, it'll say, okay, I saw what I needed to see. Or not, of course, and it'll go on its way. If you have a radio that takes a really long time to boot up, then extending this arming time out to as far as 5 seconds can help, because maybe your radio needs to bind. When you plug everything in, the receiver has to boot up first, then it has to bind, and then it starts outputting a signal. So sometimes you may want a little bit more arming time. If you're really impatient and you don't want to wait 5 seconds or even 1.5 seconds, you can set this arming time all the way down to 1 second and get running a half of a second sooner if you're really wanting to get out on the rocks. Last, we have here voltage cutoff, or almost last, I should say. And typically auto LiPo is good enough. It's going to be set at about 3.2 volts per cell when we do it that way. Or you can set the bulk cutoff or no cutoff. Typically auto LiPo is good enough. And they also have some descriptions here that you can read through if you wanted to. And lastly on here, we have throttle deadband. And the throttle deadband is the center of your throttle where neutral position is. So how much of a room do you want for your neutral position? If you have a radio that's low quality, or maybe the throttle pot has started to drift on your trigger, then you'll want a wider deadband. But if you have a nicer radio and you want the most feel on your throttle, then you will want a pretty tight deadband. What settings do you like for your deadband? Average works pretty good for me, 0.1 millisecond throttle deadband, but you can go super small down here as far as what looks to be, what would that be, a 40th? Very small, very small. 10%, 5%. What would that be, a 20th, I think? 5% of a millisecond. So very small. Very small there. It actually says very small. I would go back to average. The stock settings work just fine. Now that we have all of our settings put in how we would want, or how I would want, on the settings, then we can hit update. There we go. It writes it, it updates it, and it says okay, and we hit okay. So on your rig, maybe you want different settings, and if you do, let me know down below. Maybe you like your drag brake a little higher or a little lower. I guess you can't go higher than 100% on this particular ESC, but on some ESCs they do actually have settings higher than 100%. Maybe you don't want full reverse on there, or maybe you're going to give this to your child and you want to turn down the power a little bit. So there's some other settings that you can tweak, or some other ways that you can set up the ESC to get a more custom driving feel. But for the most part, the stock settings on the BRXL are what I prefer for any brushed motors when I go out. So that's what I use, and that's pretty much what we kept on here today. So that's pretty much it. We'll reverse the order of operations. We unplug the ESC from the programming chip first. And you can see, since it's connected, we have both a red light and a green light. Once we unplug the ESC, we will only see the red light, and that lets us know it doesn't see it. Our Castle Link also updated to show we're not plugged into anything except for the USB programming chip, as you can see right here. And then we can unplug our programming chip from the USB cable directly, or from the actual computer itself. So we'll just unplug it from the computer itself and leave it as one whole cable. Maybe there's a slightly different order of operations that you would prefer. If you have a different order of operations, then let us know in the comments. But otherwise, it's pretty straightforward. Plug it in from the computer out to the motor controller, and then go backwards when you're unplugging it from the system, and that'll make sure that you don't have any errors on there. You always want to make sure that you wait until it is updating the settings completely in your programming software. Otherwise, you can actually brick your ESC. If it's updating it and you unplug it halfway, it can just wreck the memory inside your ESC. So never do that. Make sure that you don't have kids running around that like to fiddle with things if you're playing with it. You know, keep a control on the objects, because that's probably the worst thing that can happen to an ESC. Sometimes you can't even send it to the factory and have it unbricked. It just really depends on what gets corrupted in there when that happens. So that's really about it. If you do have any more questions, you can post them down below and I'll get to them. So thanks for tuning in today. Have a good one.